The third ventricle is on the midline, and it is pictured here, right in here on the cast, and here, this area on the cadaveric brain. It's very hard to see the third ventricle when you cut the brain in half because it's very, very thin. Its walls are formed by the diencephalon, which is this area of the brain in here, the hypothalamus and the thalamus. We'll talk a lot more about these structures when we talk about gray matter and cortex and some other deeper structures. But for now, they form kind of a narrow cavity for that is your third ventricle. The lateral ventricles, as we've already talked about, empty into the third ventricle via the interventricular foramen. Cerebrospinal fluid then flows out of the third ventricle via the cerebral aqueduct into the fourth ventricle. I want to bring your attention to this little midline structure here, which corresponds to this little circle or this kind of a negative space in the cast. This is called the massa intermedia. And the massa intermedia is simply a lump of neurons that holds your the two hemispheres of your thalamus together. So your thalamus sits in the middle of your brain, deep in the middle of your brain, and it's two kind of potato-y-like or fist-like structures. And there's one on each side, but just in the middle, there's this little bridge of cells, and it's called the massa intermedia. We can assign no specific function to it, but it makes this area here that you can see when you cut it, and it makes this kind of negative impression in a ventricular cast. The fourth ventricle lies here, and it's underneath the cerebellum. So here's our cerebellum, squirrely here, and here's our fourth ventricle. Cerebrospinal fluid flows into it from the third through the cerebral aqueduct into this fourth ventricle. It's also on the midline. Now, cerebrospinal fluid, this is the last stop for cerebrospinal fluid on the midline in the ventricular system. It exits through three foramina. There is one foramen of Magendie on the midline. Note the alliteration, Magendie and midline. And there are two lateral foramen, the foramen of Luschka. And these are the areas, these little tiny foramen are how the cerebrospinal fluid gets out of the ventricular system and into the subarachnoid space. First, I'm going to talk about the choroid plexus. The choroid plexus, we can see here, it's this lumpy stuff. It kind of looks, if you put it on a histology slide, it kind of looks like a bunch of grapes. It's a simple cuboidal epithelium. There's blood supply to it, and that is how it makes cerebrospinal fluid. It's kind of like a little filter. Cerebrospinal fluid is actually very like plasma. It contains a lot less protein. It contains no cells, really, to speak of. If there are cells in your cerebrospinal fluid, you are one sick puppy. It usually means that you've got some sort of infection and you've got white blood cells that have infiltrated, and that is definitely not a good thing. So the choroid plexus is in all of the ventricles. It's indicated kind of by this pink here in the cast. We painted it pink to indicate that there is choroid plexus there, but it's in all of the ventricles. Again, on this image, you can see here's that anterior horn of the lateral ventricle. Here's the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle, and here's the body. So you can see the full range of the extent of that lateral ventricle, and you can almost, I wish if I was a bug and I could just travel down through this little gap, then you'd be traveling down toward the midline and into the third ventricle. So the flow of CSF, we're going to review in the next slide. So again, we have our two lateral ventricles. Lateral ventricles. We've got the anterior horn, the inferior horn, posterior horn, trigone, and body. We've got the third ventricle and the fourth ventricle. So cerebrospinal fluid is made all through here, okay? All through these ventricles, and then it exits through the interventricular foramen into the third, from the third to the cerebral, through the cerebral aqueduct into the fourth, and then, oh, I already wrote that, and then out through two foramina of Luschka and one midline foramen of Magendie, and then it goes into the subarachnoid space. Once it's in the subarachnoid space, that's where it's doing its main work, where it's floating your brain so that your brain doesn't squish your brainstem. It doesn't squish the blood vessels that are coming up through the neck and into the base of the skull. And it doesn't squish your cranial nerves, which are leaving your brainstem to go out and innervate things in your face and your head and neck. So it's very important that you have CSF. If you have too much, we call it hydrocephaly. And it can happen. Hydrocephaly can actually occur during fetal life or in a neonate. Sometimes the cerebral aqueduct is too narrow and it cannot escape. And so it keeps being formed and then presses up against the outside of the skull. And if it's before the fontanelles have closed, you end up with the typical appearance of that very large cranium. These days, we're very good at diagnosing and very good at catching anything like hydrocephalus when it's very, very early, and they put in what's called a shunt, and so that the extra CSF can exit the system and go harmlessly into the abdomen. They'll run the shunt all the way down into the abdomen, and that way you have just enough CSF, but not too much, and you don't squish the brain. And again, how this is the way that once it's in this subarachnoid space, how we get it resorbed. The arachnoid granulations pushing into that dural sinus, which is on the venous side of circulation. What I want to bring up at this point is the fact that the choroid plexus and the arachnoid granulations, for some odd reason, I don't know why, don't talk to one another. So you get a constant creation of cerebrospinal fluid by the choroid plexus, and a constant absorption of CSF by the arachnoid granulations. And so usually that's in balance. Usually that's just fine, and your brain is floating and everybody's happy. But every now and then, like I said, if there's a blockage somewhere, something has gone wrong in like the cerebral aqueduct or maybe one of the foramina of Luschka or Magendie, and it can't exit, you get a buildup within the brain, and then the brain will be squished. There are also other things like inflammation. If there's been something like meningitis and the arachnoid granulations become inflamed, they may become slightly scarred, and cerebrospinal fluid can't get out of the arachnoid granulations back into the venous blood flow. So those are bad things, and we always try to keep a very close eye on those kinds of things. I'm not a clinician. The neurology people keep an eye on that kind of stuff to make sure that that doesn't happen. So in summary, what I want you to know is how many ventricles there are, what are their names, and specifically with that lateral ventricle, know which horn is in what part of the cortex, where is cerebrospinal fluid made, and who makes it, how does cerebrospinal fluid circulate through the ventricle, so be able to trace that entire path, and then once cerebrospinal fluid is out of the ventricular system, where does it go? That subarachnoid space, and then how is it absorbed out of the subarachnoid space into the venous circulation? If you know all of these kinds of things, then you're ready to take the assessment.